Well, good morning.
Good morning.
All right. this is actually going to be the first time that I've ever spoken in a Methodist church. So, you know, I have a Baptist background, and so that's whenever I've spoken, it's always been at a Baptist church. I've never spoken at a Methodist church. So I promise not to throw in Baptist stuff in there. Okay? Just kidding. Dave asked, you know, he's out with his family. This week, so he asked me if I would just come and just share my testimony so that you could kind of get to know me a little more and just where I've been up to this point and where God has taken me and how God has impacted my life and why I do youth ministry. And so that's what I'm gonna tell you this morning is just my testimony. I'll just start there. I'm married. You know, Amy's my wife, and we've been married almost 17 years this year. So, so we met a long time ago. at a bowling alley. That was the first time we met each other. So we went to a bowling alley and. So we bowled with some friends of ours, and that's really how we actually met, was she had some friends, I had some friends, and the same friends, and they hooked us up together. So we went to the bowling alley, and that's where we first met. Well, you know, we got to talk and everything at the bowling alley and all that good stuff, and then, so as we were talking, I was like, hey, you know, you want to go out sometime? She was like, yeah, sure. So I left. I was going out to my truck, but I didn't ask her for her phone number. I left. And so she was like, she chased me outside to the parking lot. I was like, hey, do you want my phone number? So I was like, oh, yeah, that's I need your phone number. She don't remember, but she did. She didn't really chase me, but she kind of, you know, she wanted to make sure I had her number. Because I didn't, you know, I was nervous whenever I asked, you know, her if she wanted to go out. So I didn't even think about asking for her phone number. And but anyway, that's where we first met. And so we've been married almost 17 years. We got two wonderful kids, Matthew and Julianne. God has blessed me with that family. And when you hear my story, you'll understand more why I'm so much appreciative of how God has blessed me with my wife and kids. I went to seminary, New Orleans Baptist Theological Seminary. And I got my master's degree in marriage and family counseling, focused in psychology. And the reason why I went there was because they do what I would consider a great job of integration of psychology, theology, and spirituality. So they really they're not really teaching Baptist stuff. They're teaching, you know, where you learn all the theologies of all the religions. And they're teaching spirituality because when it comes to substance abuse, they often do a spiritual aspect in the recovery, and also the psychology of things, and so they really integrate when it comes to biblical interpretation and biblical practice and utilizing what God has given us in His Word and how to use that in counseling and when you're trying to help people to get from where they're at to where they want to go. And so being able to do that and learn that, I felt like that they did a wonderful job in that. So that's really been my focus since being a Christian, is how can I help people more? One of the things that I'm always fascinated with is why people do the things that they do. You know, it just amazes me the things that people do and say, and I always wonder, why did they say that, or why did they do that? And, you know, when we get into the more serious acts of things, like, you know, if you remember many years ago, where a father, you know, took his children and threw them off the Dolphin Island Bridge. Like, why? And those kinds of things, you know, as horrific as they are, really just fascinates me, like, what was going through that man's mind? What was going on that he would do such things? And you know, just with all the other things that go on around our world, just I'm always intrigued as to why people do the things that they do. Why do people just ignore family? Why do people just, you know, treat their children negatively, rudely? Just, you know, it just always fascinated me. I just always just had a heart for that. So while I was in New Orleans and going to school in New Orleans, it was a 3-year degree. Ended up doing a little over 100 hours of psychology while I was there. And while there, I was able to work at several different places over there. Several different recovery places, places where they do counseling. And so I got to work with a menagerie of clients. I mean, just from one extreme to the next, people who said, hey, you know what, I have a hard time organizing, you know, my life. I just need help organizing, getting things straight. To other people who are going through marital issues where they believe certain things, and it was like, you know, you're having marital problems because of what you believe. And it was really hard to get people to understand that. And so while there, I just worked with a whole menagerie of different issues and clients, and so it was really fascinating to me to be able to do that and hear, you know, their perception of what's going on. And then to be able to look at it through, you know, the Bible and say, well, you know, this is why things are not going the way that they should, because they lack a biblical worldview. And so it was really interesting for me. But getting to that, you know, I'm 44 years old, and I grew up in a family that was, not the perfect family, not the ideal family. I had two brothers, two sisters. One brother right now is incarcerated in a federal prison for armed robbery out of a bank. I have another brother who's in Michigan who my sister lives with him, and she is blind. She's been blind since birth, and they live in Michigan. We have no contact with them. Also, I have another sister who lives locally, but you know, we don't really have any contact with them either. My mother passed away several years ago. My father I haven't seen over 20 years. He's never met my wife or kids or anything. So growing up, I was born in Mobile, so growing up, we would always move around a lot. Whenever I was first born, in Mobile, we ended up moving to California, where it was crazy. We were there for a couple of years. We ended up moving to Indiana. We lived there for a couple of years. We ended up moving to Montgomery. We ended up moving to Pineapple. We ended up moving back to Indiana. We moved around probably 15 to 20 times. And it wasn't because my dad was in the military. It was because my mother and father would always get into these arguments. And so whenever it got real bad, my mom would just pack us all up and we'd leave. And so we ended up just moving around everywhere. And so we went through several years of that. We ended up moving back to Mobile. My parents finally got divorced when I was about 15 years old. I went on a trip with a friend of mine to Texas, and we were gone for about a week and a half. He was helping his family move to Mobile, and I went with him to help him do that. And when I got back, my father was no longer there, but we had a new family, and we had a my mother had kicked my dad out and got another guy to come in, and he had two kids. So going from one, you know, going, leaving, and my dad was there, and then coming back, and no dad there, and this new family is living in the house. So it was quite an odd, strange experience. So later on, a few years later, I would graduate from high school, and graduated on June 6th. Ended up joining the military the day after. I went to the Marine Corps on June 7th. My birthday was on June 8th. And so I ended up joining the Marines. And so while I was in the Marines, I went into the infantry, but I ended up getting put into Force Recon. And that was a more special operations combat unit. So I ended up going with communications. So while I was in communications, we ended up going to 29 Palms, California, and ended up just going from one place to another with training and everything like that. So I ended up in Dammnick, Virginia, which is the Navy and Marine Corps Intelligence Center. So I went there, and this is really where things started to get kind of crazy for me. When I went into the when I went here to the Marines, Navy Marine Center, they really started to teach you about analytical thinking, and so that's really where I started to begin a lot of self-reflection and just the experiences that I had. Because before that, I really didn't care what I did. I didn't really care where I went. I didn't really have any concern for any of that. But once I got here and they started teaching us about intelligence and, you know, having that analytical mind and being able to see things that nobody else sees, it really started to really challenge me in the way that I was thinking. Now, this is before I became a Christian. And so while there, I really just really started to struggle a lot. And this is where I would consider that I went down into a spiral emotionally, mentally. And so there were a lot of times where I would begin to say, you know, say things like, you know, why am I even here? And so then a few years later, a few months later, I ended up getting deployed to Kuwait during Desert Storm and Desert Shield. I was over there for about 18 months and had a lot of different experiences over there. And that really just put me back into a more of a spiral, and just became really angry about things, really bitter about stuff. Really started wondering, like, why did I have the family that I had? Why couldn't I have a healthier family where I wouldn't be messed up like I am right now? And so I really got into, you know, using drugs and alcohol and just living, you know, on the edge, basically. And so I was there for about 18 months, and I really struggled with that for many years. And then I finally came back, got discharged from the Marines, and then after that, yeah, I had to get a job. I had to get a real job, but I had a lot of emotional issues, so I really didn't really want a job. I was kind of homeless for a while. And then at that time, my mom let me move in with her for a little while. And so I ended up getting this job with a security company and started working there. Well, I met a chaplain who was a Army chaplain at the time, and he was a part-time chaplain, and so he was a reservist, so he was working there as well. And he started talking to me, and I really didn't want anything to do with him. Didn't want nothing to do with him. So he would continually, every day, every time that I saw him, he would always present the gospel to me. He'd always talk to me about the Bible. He'd always talk to me about Jesus Christ, and I never wanted anything to do. So this went on for months, and until finally one day, he came to me and he was like, you know, Sean, do you want to accept Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior? And I was like, no way, no way. And I was like, look, you know, I said a few choice words, but I said, but don't talk to me about Jesus Christ. I don't want to hear about it. Well, after that day, about a week later, and I was staying with my mom's house, and had a water bed. Now, I don't know if you've ever had a water bed, but I had a water bed. It was a queen size water bed, and doesn't really have much of an edge on it, but I remember getting up Saturday morning, and I remember, you know, just something taking over me and just saying, you need to accept Jesus Christ. And so I got on the side of my bed, and I was like, you know what, you're right. And so that was the morning that I gave my life to Jesus Christ. And that was the moment that everything changed for me. And that was the moment that I could really sense the change in the way that I thought, in the way that I felt, and just having this release of everything that I had been carrying, all these burdens that I'd been having on me for so many years, just all of a sudden just lift off of me. And I remember thinking, like, wow, what if I felt really free? And so a few days later, as I went back to work, I went to a friend of mine. His name was Mitch. And I went to him, and I said, you know what I said for Jesus Christ? And I remember his response. Excuse me. But he was so happy that I did that, you know? And he brought several other people who were Christians, and I told them all, and it was like a celebration almost. It was crazy. So that began my transformation in the way that I thought, in the way that I acted, in the way that I behaved, and just the way that I treated people. It just changed my whole life from that point on. And so, you know, when I talk about my wife, I'm like, I never thought I could ever have anything of what I have today. But God had a different plan for me. It was a pretty challenging experience. There were many nights where I would, before I accepted Jesus Christ, there were many nights I just asked God to just take my, you know, just, why can't I just die? And often attempted suicide on several occasions because I was such in a dark place and didn't want to live anymore. But it was amazing how God changed the way that I felt and the way that I thought. And I'm still amazed by that. I'm still just astounded by what he had done for me. And then just to have all the blessings that I have today, it's just amazing to me. I mean, I still feel like sometimes, you know what, I don't deserve all that. But God loves me enough that he gave me the family that I have, because I didn't have a family growing up. I didn't have all that. I didn't have relationships with my sisters and brothers and mother and father. Didn't have that thing where, you know, dad goes outside throwing the ball. Didn't have all that because my father was an alcoholic. He drove trucks, so he was gone a lot of time. He was over the road. My mom didn't really care. She was doing her own thing. She ended up having, you know, she was married like 6 times and had many affairs. And so once we all left the home, all the brothers and sisters, we didn't have any contact with each other. And I remember when I first became a Christian, I started to change in my life, and the things that I was doing, it started to build a wall between me and my family. Not that there wasn't one before, but it really created a divide because I still had some type of, once I became a Christian, I felt God leading me away from all that, because it was a terrible environment to be in. It was a terrible place to be in. And, so when the Bible talks about where, you know, the Word of God, when people are changed, that it begins to develop a divide between father and son, between mother and daughter, friends, it just creates a division when you accept Jesus Christ. And that was my experience. Was that when I accepted Jesus Christ, it began to create a division between the only people that I knew, and to begin to create a new family, which was the church family, because I got baptized and developed relationships with people in the churches, and that became the family that I knew I needed. And then later on, I met my wife, who I never thought I would never get married. I mean, who would want to marry somebody that was crazy, right? So, but she must have been crazy to marry me, right? But no, for real, I mean, she is exactly what I needed, even after, you know, almost 17 years of marriage. I've just come to realize that God knew what I needed before I needed it. In 2 Corinthians 10:5, it says, "We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ." Now, a lot of people think that all I do is sit around and analyze people, which is kind of true. Whenever I started going to seminary and started to learn psychology, and I'd come home and I'd be like, "Amy, I think you have this diagnosis. I think this is you." And she would be like, "Go away." And so I, you know, because what would happen is I'd go to seminary in New Orleans and stay there for the week and then come back on the weekends. But so through all the everything that I was learning during the week, I'd come home and be like, "Hey, man, I really think that you got this right here." And so it was always something different every week. And then finally, she would just be sitting there reading, "Yeah, sure, honey, okay, whatever." And then I'm like, your brother is this right here. So it really started to expand. So now I don't really analyze her anymore. I just analyze everybody else. So a lot of people think that, you know, when they hear that I do clinical psychology and I do a lot of family counseling and stuff, that they begin to think, is he analyzing me? And probably so, because it's just one of those things that God has just put in me to just really understand why people do the things that they do. It's always been just a fascination of mine. Why do people do the things that they do? And this verse here, it talks about taking every thought captive. That whatever we think, we need to bring that thought into captivity. And that was something that I really struggled with. And this is really kind of a life verse for me, because I had so many negative and ugly thoughts growing up, and so many different experiences that a lot of people don't really experience, and it really just it can create just a lot of unhealthy thoughts. And so when I read this verse and really started to think about it, I was like, you know what, this is what I need to be doing. I need to be thinking and doing every thought that comes into my mind. I need to be challenging that thought. Is this thought of God? Is this thought biblical? Is this thought focused on doing good things, not bad things? Is this a healthy thought or unhealthy thought? And so when I read this verse, this really has become my life verse in everything that I think. So a lot of times when you see me and I don't really talk or whatever, it's because I'm thinking about something, about is it good or bad? You know, what should I say before I say it? I do spend a lot of time doing that because of all the bad things that I had experienced growing up. And so that's why I really am challenged a lot every day about what am I thinking, what am I doing? So this has become my life verse. So my challenge to you is this verse. You know, how much time do we spend thinking about our thoughts? Is this a good thought? What am I doing? What am I saying? How is the person on the other side going to receive what I'm about to say? And it took me a long time to really think about that and to really be more concerned about the other person rather than myself. And that's hard to do. And so that would be my challenge for you, that is to bring every thought under His authority, to bring every thought under His subjection, and to pray and say, God, you know, is this a good thought? Should I say this? How are they going to respond? How will they receive what I'm about to say? And so that's, you know, so like I say, I spend a lot of time doing that. And that's why I don't really talk a lot, because I'm constantly thinking about, well, how will I respond to this? How will I respond to that? And so when I do counseling, I'll always have to try to be smarter than the other person. I need to know more than they know, because when it comes to manipulation, we're really good at that. And clients, especially when it comes to substance abuse, they are really good at that. They know how to manipulate somebody in order to get what they need. But we all are like that, whether we have substance abuse problems or not. We all are pretty good at trying to get what we want through manipulation, no matter if it's small or large. And so you know, so when I get someone in my office, I have to try to be smarter than them. What's their angle? What's going on? Are they telling me the truth? Is this real? Is this not real? Is it fake? So it really takes a lot of time thinking about what's going on in these people's minds. And that's why, you know, this verse is such a life verse, because to bring every thought under His authority. And it's a challenge. It's not easy. But when it comes to witness and it comes to testimony, in the scripture it talks about the martyria. It's in the Greek. And it means testimony, reputation, evidence, and witness. And so in the verse it says, "My mouth will tell you of your righteous deeds, of your saving acts all day long. Though I know not how to relate them all, I will come and proclaim your mighty acts, sovereign Lord. I will proclaim your righteous deeds and yours alone." When it comes to being a witness, martyria is where we get the word martyrdom from. It's a martyr. So when it comes to being a witness, it's being a martyr has to be a part of that witness. Suffering because of following Jesus Christ, that's not an easy thing. And through my experience, that was my experience, because when I accepted Jesus Christ, it created a division with my family, who I have no relationship with today. My wife and her family are the only relationships that I have. But God has blessed me with that, because he knew what I didn't have, and I could see her and have her and her family and know what it looks like to have a healthy family, because I came from an unhealthy family. And so it's really amazing to be able to look at that, because I remember when I was taking a class and I had to do a genealogy, excuse me, and a genealogy, I had to do one on her family and I had to do one on mine. Well, on her side, it was pretty cleaned up. I mean, you know, nothing going on there. On my side, it had all these lines going everywhere. So it was pretty fascinating to see when you put it down on paper. And so when I looked at that, I was like, pretty messed up, pretty healthy. So it was quite funny, but and we laugh about it sometimes. But so I would encourage you to bring every thought under His authority, you know, because what we say really affects other people. And the only way that we can affect people in a positive way is we think about what we say before we say it. Because a lot of times we just talk just for the sake of speaking, and we don't really think about what we're saying until after the fact. Well, you know what, I shouldn't have said that. Especially when it comes to emotional control, self-control, you know, which is one of the fruits of the Spirit. And we don't really develop that as Christians a lot of times. And so we really need to get focused on what we think before we say it. So let's pray. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for this opportunity to be able to just share my testimony, Father. I just thank you that I'm able to do that. I appreciate the opportunity to maybe encourage somebody, to just be able to relate to somebody. And Father, just ask that you will, through all of this, be glorified through my life, and how you have changed me, and how you have blessed me, how you brought me out of what your word says, the miry clay, and you put my feet on solid ground, and you blessed me with a family whom I never thought I could have. You blessed me with a church family. You blessed me with being able to have Christian friends and to be able to fellowship with those who believe in me. Father, just thank you for this opportunity, for blessing me. Lord, and I just pray that if there's anyone in this room who doesn't know your son Jesus Christ, who maybe doubt if they know your son Jesus Christ, I just ask that you will draw them to you and put people in their place, in their life, in their path, that will be able to encourage them and to show them and how to know you as their Lord and Savior. So, Father, thank you again for all that you do and all that you will do. And we just pray all this in your son Jesus Christ's name. Thank you for giving me the opportunity to share the gospel share my testimony with you. So, all right, you're free to go.